Hello, and welcome to Family Matters. Many people, maybe yourself, have had consultation with a psychologist or a counselor to deal with a personal or family problem. One assumes that their interventions are supported by facts about human functioning. Well, is that really true? Knowledge about human behavior is a work in progress, and so is Bowen Family Systems Theory, which offers a conceptual framework for explaining family functioning. As Murray Bowen said, referring to the theory he developed, this is an open theory, open to be tested, expanded, enriched, or even disproved. Enriching and expanding the theory is exactly what my guest did with her most recent publication, The Family Emotional System, an integrative concept for theory, science, and practice. It is a group of articles addressing the science behind family systems theory and its application. Dr. Daniel Papero has written numerous articles and book chapters on various aspects of family systems theory and family psychotherapy. He has extensive clinical experience with families and maintains a practice in Washington, D.C. Dr. Robert Noone has been a practicing family psychotherapist for more than 40 years. Dr. Noone is co-founder of the Center of Family Consultation in Evanston, Illinois, which has been providing programs on Bowen theory for the past 35 years. Dr. Noone is a nationally recognized presenter on Bowen theory, psychotherapy, and authored numerous articles on the subject. Welcome to Family Matters.
Thank you. Good to be here.
So, what can we expect of this new book you just edited? What can we get out of it? What does it add to the conversation?
Gee, what a good question. Well, it certainly adds dimension to a conversation. Much of the conversation that goes on around the problems that turn up in a therapist's office have to do with some sort of notions about the interior world of that person. Almost all psychotherapy focuses on the individual, and the notion is that if you can change something in that internal world, the person is different. And what the science is saying, all the way from the diagnostic level up to the emergence of problems, is that that is not a particularly useful way to think about things. For example, all psychotherapy revolves around the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, the famous DSM, that we're now in the fifth edition of. In spite of the fact that there exists almost no scientific evidence to justify a categorical model, that is, diagnosis by a diagnosis, as a way of explaining or even comprehending human behavior. And if you start from there, if that fundamental thing is wrong, then in a certain sense, almost all of the therapies that are focused on shifting this categorical internal state are off base, to some degree anyway. What's much more important seems to be the context in which the individual is developing, and the science is coming in more and more and more to support that, all the way from the level of the development of an individual cell up to the development of a human being, up to the development of a family system across time, something like that. That would be my shot at that.
So what you're saying is that this book offers the possibility of broadening the lens.
Expanding the viewpoint, yep, mm-hmm. And the conversation.
How about you, Dr. Noone? What do you think is a takeaway of a book like this, which is pretty rich and complex, but?
Yeah, and I think it differs for different people. Certainly, I think one of the things that's useful is for many people in the world of psychotherapy who have not been associated with Bowen theory for a prolonged period of time would see it as a theory from the past, that it is, was developed by Dr. Bowen and remains a static theory. My own point of view is that it has been a theory that has been very dynamic and developing over decades now. And I think the book captures some of the development of that theory from practitioners who utilize Bowen theory and looking at trying to develop aspects of it, to the scientists who have been interested and have contributed based on their own work to a broader view of human behavior. So I'm hoping that the book captures some of that, this dialogue that has been going on among Bowen theorists and clinicians and scientists from a number of different disciplines.
So in what ways has the theory been changed as a result of this discussion? Because it seems like the eight concepts that comprise the theory are still the eight concepts, and differentiation of self, the core concept or the cornerstone concept. So that's still the same. So in what ways has it changed?
Well, I think the Bowen developed a very broad theory. So each of those eight concepts, you could spend a lifetime trying to develop based on what's out there in the world of science. And so I think what has changed has been a filling in of the concept. So if you think about something like differentiation of self, and as I understood it, I think I had a very narrow view of it. As I've read in the neurosciences, expanded my knowledge of it. And it's not just my knowledge and my reading, but there has been an ongoing, group of individuals interested in science and reading in the sciences, interacting with one another, shaping the development of our own thinking and of the thinking about the theory. So knowledge from the other fields, I think, has contributed to a much richer sense of the various concepts. And I think that applies across the board. If you think about the family adaptive mechanisms that Bowen described in the family or nuclear process, in terms of the stress response literature, looking at concepts like allostasis and allostatic load, I mean, they're catching what Bowen was really observing and how the family was adapting. And so I think this effort to try and look at not just the individual as adapting, but the family as a unit adapting, which influences the individual's adaptation, is important.
Mm-hmm. So it hasn't changed altogether the construction of the theory, but the details and the way it actually operates is what has been enriched by this dialogue with the sciences.
I think so. I don't see any of the concepts as having changed. Again, they're very broad, and I think they probably will be modified to some point in the future, and maybe some of them, as you mentioned, will be refuted. But I think the important thing is that here is a theory that allows for a way to go about studying a phenomena, the human family, and explore it in all kinds of dimensions. And whether it stands the test of time will probably take several generations. But so far, it looks pretty good in terms of what is developing in the sciences.
Dr. Papero, one of the main things about Bowen theory, the greatest contribution, is moving away from the individual to the systems perspective or systems thinking, as you just said. In what ways other science in different fields support or help a Bowen theorist to move even further into the systems thinking? In what ways the science is useful to do that change from the individual to the system?
Well, you know, Dr. Noone has talked about the stress system. One of the most interesting things is to go and look at the animal research, which is very clearly indicating that the interactional process between the infant and even pre-birth and the caregiver, usually a mother in the animal world, is literally regulating the intensity of the infant's stress response, how sensitive, how reactive that infant is. And that changes both the interaction ultimately between the caregiver and that infant, but also how that infant is experiencing the world. And it's powerful that this infant development is not an automaton that's just unfolding in a genetic sense, but literally the interaction with the parent is shaping how intense that stress response is shaping what that infant is sensitive to in the world, and then the ongoing interaction between infant and caregiver and then between infant and others in the environment is beginning to shape literally the developmental trajectory of that infant over time, shaping who that one is going to be in very fundamental and profound ways. And when you see it that way, you begin to see that whatever walks in your office that is presenting as an individual symptom has a developmental history to it that is based in these interactional sequences. is based in these context things. And if the social psychologists are right when they say if you can change the context, you can change your behavior, it suggests that the individual making an effort to shift his or her own position and functioning within a relationship network may be much more profound as a mechanism of change, both for that individual and for the relationship system in which he or she participates, than any number of hours spent talking with a psychiatrist or a psychologist about the internal world of the individual. It's, in terms of efficiency and effectiveness, it's light years apart in how this operates.
Something like this natural sciences doesn't allow us to think in simplistic terms,
no.
In terms of cause and effect.
Absolutely not.
So it really pushes us to go to the
cause complex. And effect isn't going to get us there, and it's so clear that that's the case. But our human brains, and this is another piece that's been extraordinarily useful to me in thinking about neuroscience and so on, is that our brains are in a sense set up to do simple causation. And it requires a much more sophisticated effort with one's own thinking to step out of that and see the bigger context in which specific markers of behavior are developing and playing out over time.
Dr. Noone, for you, which of the contributions in the book is one of the ones that stay like most exciting for you, interesting, or, you know, something that you think, oh my God, this, somebody has to read it.
I don't know if I could do that, because one of the things I'm impressed about was, first of all, that these scientists who are very busy in their own careers were willing to take the time to write a chapter for this book. There was something about the concept of the book that they found important enough to want to do that.
So they are not all related to Bowen theory?
No, they were really geared towards describing their own field. And so when you asked about what's the most important, well, from top to bottom, it starts out with Dr. Frances Champagne talking about epigenetics. And she's looking at the epigenetics involved in parenting, which includes not just mothers, but includes fathers. So at a very at the molecular basis now, they're beginning to track the influence of mother on child, father on child. And she's also describing that you can't just look at the molecular basis, that everything in nature is bidirectional. So the molecular basis is being influenced by these interactional patterns between mother and father and with the child. So that to me was very exciting, to the whole field of epigenetics, and she's a pioneer in that. If you think about something like primate studies, with Dr. Charles Snowden describing the substrates involved in attachment and bonding between parents and offspring. So he talks about a species in which fathers are very involved in parenting. And to me, it's mind-blowing to think about what's operating at a very basic level, but the basic level is influenced by what's happening at other levels. But describing how fathers, at a physiological level, get involved in parenting. So they've understood for some time that the attachment hormones are activated in mother during the pregnancy, and she becomes primed to take care of the infant when the infant's born. But then the question was, how do fathers get involved? What makes them engaged with taking care of the infant? And just as one example that he mentions in the book, which is just fascinating, is that about midway through the pregnancy, the adrenal gland of the embryo releases a hormone, which is picked up by the mother, and mother releases that hormone in her urine, and that activates father's hormonal system and changes his own levels of attachment and being primed towards taking care of the infant. So here you have all of these levels. It's not causation, but all of these levels involved and interactionally. So the infant is actually playing part in engaging father even during the pregnancy. So. And those would be two examples. I mean, the studies with infants, with insects, and looking at the degree to which colonies regulate the behavior of members. No one's in charge, which I think is true in the family. People like to think someone's in charge of the family or in a business, and nobody is in charge of it. Everybody is influencing one another. And to see this played out in the careful studies that Dr. Deborah Gordon, for example, and Dr. Gadigar describe in the populations that they study, the profound influence the social behavior of these individuals have on one another is really supportive, I think, of looking at how we humans influence each other at a very basic level that we're not usually aware of.
When you recruited, I don't know if that's the exact word, the authors that were going to participate in your book, were they surprised, these people that are working in these different areas, epigenetics or animal studies or the ant colonies, were they surprised to be called to participate in a book about the family emotional system and specifically about Bowen theory?
I don't know a specific answer to that. I would suspect perhaps a little, but what struck me was how willing they were to do it. We didn't have to cajole anybody to do this or plead with people. They stepped forward and seemed eager and willing to do this. And that was just very impressive to me, that they saw this as somehow useful or important to do. I suppose some of them were a bit surprised. I don't really know, but
I guess my question was going to understanding in what ways they thought, but I don't know if you can say that, they're not here, but in what ways they thought it was, their research was important for a clinician working with a family in an office, maybe like very concrete case-by-case situation.
I do think many of the major scientists wonder about whether any of their findings are useful to people in the real world, in a certain sense. And I think that the interest that Bowen theory people have shown in their work, and that even though they're studying insects, their work has relevance to humans, is, I think, probably valuable and stimulating to them. I don't know. What would your thought be on that, Bob?
I think so. I think most of those scientists know that their work has relevance for human behavior, but they, I think, oftentimes wonder whether or not it's picked up by people who aren't in their field. So I think they're very interested in the fact that there's a group of practitioners who are interested in their work and see its relevance for human behavior. And not just its relevance for understanding human behavior, but actually being able to assist individuals and families in their own functioning to improve their life situation. The other piece was that I don't think they were surprised at the request, because all of them had been involved in meetings discussing their work with people who were using Bowen theory for their clinical practice. So there had been a dialogue over the years with a number of them. All of them actually have been involved at meetings. So they, I think, saw the relevance immediately and were very interested in presenting their work in this book.
Both of you are clinicians and scholars at the same time. What would you say about the importance or the mindset of the clinician in relation to knowledge from the scientific field or the scientific community? Dr. Papero.
One of the observations that Dr. Bowen made in his research project at the NIMH was, as he described it, that the families who were involved in the research seemed to do better than families who weren't. And it led to this interest in what a research attitude on the part of the clinician might do. And so it's led to this very interesting rediscovery, in a certain sense, of what used to be considered standard in the field, the clinician as researcher. Now, we've lost track of that. 25, 35 years ago, that was the model, that clinicians were researchers, in a certain sense. And so in a sense, it brings that back to the fore, but also that it's very, very useful clinically when the clinician can stay in the position of someone who is interested in the family and interested in learning about how the family works. That seems to be very important in the family's ability to sort itself out effectively. No, that would be my shot at that.
So more than trying to fix what is wrong in the family, observing and learning, that seems to be more useful as an
It has to me in my practice over the years, and it seems to be that way. It's a more difficult thing for a clinician to get in that position because we are all empathic human beings. We have this urge. We feel with the other person. And there's a tremendous pressure on a clinician to step in and fix the problem, which is not easy to do. Mm-hmm. And when people can stay out of that, I think the family does better.
In your experience, Dr. Noone, how your effort to be in touch with different areas in science has helped you as a clinician? Because you don't go there with the families and give them, you know, a lecture about neuroscience, right? So, In what ways, knowing what you know about all these aspects of the natural system and the family as a natural system, helps you to translate that into a better conversation with the family?
Well, it's a good question, and I think it's there's so many different levels in terms of being able to describe that. I know that a big part of it has to do with staying interested in the human phenomena, to not assuming that I know what's going on in a family, for example, or an individual, that that I'm curious and I want to find out more about what they're experiencing and how they would describe what they're up against. And I consider myself really fortunate to meet with families. You get all of this complexity that comes at you and the richness of people's lives, and be able to have them share that with you, and then to not have to try to fix it, but to try to understand it with them, to help them try to understand it. And if I am curious, hopefully family members or a family member will start getting more curious themselves. So on the one hand, at a very basic level, it communicates a certain level of respect for the family, just appreciative of the complexity of what they're up against. It is not easy, and it's not going to be changed instantly. There aren't easy solutions, but it is something that can be understood and changed. And my own sense of curiosity and respect for the family gets communicated, I think. And over time, people get curious, and I tell people right away, people who do the best with this are individuals who take themselves on as a research study. And I'm not telling them exactly how they should research themselves, other than to work at being better observers of themselves and their family. But I will introduce things from science, you know, whether it's the epigenetic piece to say, you know, your son isn't just wired this way, influenced by the context. I remember one mother I had met with the family for several months, and the son had been in and out of hospitals and various programs and received probably four or five different diagnoses. And after 4 or 5 months, mother said, you know, I'm appreciative of the fact that you have told us that we're a part of this problem. She said, this is the first time anyone has said that. And it may sound paradoxical, but it has been very helpful in thinking that when we were told by most that your son is just wired this way, it left us in a sense of a helpless position. When I recognize that I am a part of this, then I can begin to try and take a look. Can I contribute to improving or assisting my son in this effort by taking a look at the part I'm playing in? So it's actually empowering, I think, for people to begin to get a sense that they are a part of this process. And can some of the research from brain studies and also just some of the animal studies, people listen to. But I try to present it in a way in which it can be heard as well, in very simple language. Not that the phenomena is all that complex and can't be understood. The language gets to be a problem. But when you think about emotions and thinking, people intuitively grasp it pretty quickly.
So it becomes practical to know these things.
Yeah.
Very practical.
Is there a word of caution about this book that we should be aware of? Reader?
It's costly.
Okay.
What's
the risk? Let's put it that way. What would be the risk of reading this book? The risk of engaging the science, the natural sciences, when we're thinking about the family?
Well, there's always a risk when people take a single piece of science and then attempt to make it explain everything. people could come away with something and say that because scientist X said this, then they do an analogy to the family and say, well, this is the way it is, and operate out of a bias then, which doesn't have substance to it. There's always, but that's true for any kind of interaction with the human, whether it comes out of science or anything else. I don't see many downsides. I don't think this book is going to hurt anybody, unless it gets thrown at them or something.
Well, as Dr. Papero was saying, I think people can oversimplify some of the ideas in the various chapters. And I was thinking about epigenetics, for example. So when you say that it's not just genes, that the social environment influences the expression of genes, then people can start blaming themselves for the way in which my child expresses, you know, their responsiveness to stress. It is not that rigid. There is a lot of plasticity involved in hopefulness, in the sense that it's not hardwired, which offers hope, and it's not the epigenetics early in life aren't hardwired either. That can exist throughout life. So rather than blaming one's parents for my early childhood and saying I had these epigenetic changes, you can do something about your epigenetic processes in the present time. So that's I guess that would be one aspect. People often hear epigenetics as being more determining than it is, and it's actually much more, it offers more flexibility to people in terms of modifying their behavior.
All right, well, if I happen to have any adverse consequences or side effects, I'll let you know.
Call Dr. Noone.
Thank you for being here.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like to remind you that the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family offers the community affordable psychotherapy in both English and Spanish. If you would like more information about our topic or the services at the Bowen Center, please visit the website at www.thebowencenter.org or send me an email at familymatters@thebowencenter.org. You can also find us on Facebook or call 202-965-4400. Thank you for watching, and I invite you to join me again for another edition of Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, and your family does matter.